안녕하세요. 저는 하라키 유이치라고 합니다. 오늘은 안드로이드 서포트 라이브러리인 초신 정보에 대해 이야기합니다. In English. So, I'm sure that everyone here is probably already very familiar with the support library, so I'm going to skip talking about what they are. But before diving into the actual updates inside the library, let's talk about last year. So last year we dropped support for old Android devices running API level below 9, right? And this year, you know, this tiny red line is Gingerbread. So this year we dropped support for devices running API level below 14. So thank you and goodbye Gingerbread Honeycomb. So this means our Mint SDK version, support library Mint SDK version, is now 14. And which means your Mint SDK version will be 14, that's minimum, if it's not. With this change, we were able to remove 1,400 methods from the support library. So all the devices have 64K DEX limits, method counts, so this will help a lot. And also, there are many methods, about 400 methods, we have marked as deprecated. And these methods will be removed soon. So this slide is actually the most important part of this session. If you see this like deprecation warning in your code after you upgrade to 26.0.0, then this warning is not something you want to ignore. This warning will soon be an error after we remove this method from the support library. So please just migrate to the corresponding framework method. This is the most important part. You can forget about the rest of my session. I'll talk about them anyway. So Chansuk already mentioned this new MyVim repository. It's as easy as adding 2-3 lines. And this MyVim repository actually contains the entire history of the support library, not just the latest version. So it's much easier to now set up a build server like Jenkins and such. So your build.gradle will look like this. Just add MyVim to your MyVim repository, to your repositories. And if you're using Gradle version 4.4 or later, you can just use Google Parents. Now, let's briefly talk about how we develop support library. And we moved our issue tracker recently. We used to use b.android.com to accept bug reports and feature requests, but we are now on issuetracker.google.com. If you find any issue in a support library or if you have some feature requests, this is where you want to file them. And now, well, in case you want to fix some bugs in the support library yourself, you can do that now in Android Studio. Just open up the directory and Android Studio, and it works. So just in case you want to send us like a pull request, you can check out the doc, and we're going to review it, really. So we don't really get many pull requests. We call them CLs. It's just pull, something like pull requests. But I have reviewed one pull requests so far as I'm working on support library, and that one thing was actually came from South Korea. So I'm not sure if he's with us today, but thank you, and keep them coming. So let's talk about the actual features inside the support library. So we have four key features about text and fonts in the latest version. So let's briefly see what they are. Now, fonts are now a first-class citizen of Android resource system. So before, when you want to use a custom font, you will need to create like a custom view and then do all those preparations in Java. But now all you need to do is to put those font files in this font directory in the resource and you're done. Now if you want to group, like bundle several fonts as a single font family, you can use XML, new XML font family to do that. It's like this. So when you're using those fonts, you add it. In the resource file, just say @fonts/something. You can also use that in styles. And if you want to use them in Java code, you can do that as well. And this everything just works from Ice Cream Sandwich and above. So, but font files can be huge, right? If you bundle them in your APK, it's going to make your APK significantly larger. So there's also a way to download fonts on demand. Now, there's something called font provider. It just provides fonts to your app. And Google Play Services is actually a font provider. And it provides all the fonts from Google Fonts. And there are more than 800. So in order to do that, just write some kind of code like this. Yeah, good to go. And you can also do the same thing with XML. But you can actually forget about that, because if you use Android Studio, you can just select the text view. And on the right-hand side, you will yeah, the video stops, but let's pretend that we can see what's going on. And there's a font family selection there, and you can select your fonts from there. And Android Studio automatically sets all those XML files for you, so you don't need to remember the setup. For the detail, well, Chansuk already talked about it, but if you want to check out the YouTube video, it's there. And the docs. Now, emoji compats. So there are new emojis added to Unicode specification like every year. Before, people needed to wait for the new Android OS updates before using them. But we now have emoji compat support library to solve the problem. All you have to do is to add support emoji in your dependencies, and the API is almost same as the downloadable font I mentioned earlier. You can also do the bundle setup if you really want to. I recommend using the download setup, because this bundle setup is going to make your APK larger by like 7 megs. So when you're using emoji, just use this emoji text view instead of the normal text view, and the emoji will be shown on the latest. The latest emojis are shown on all the devices as well. So you can show tacos and unicorns and things like that. So for the docs, here are the docs. So this library itself is Min SDK version 14, but it's only 19 and above that it actually works, that it actually displays emojis. Text field sizing. So these blue boxes are text fields, and as they gets larger and smaller, you can see that the text size changes automatically. And this is as easy as adding a single line, alt size, text type, and uniform. There are more parameters you can specify if you want to fine tune the behavior, and this works ice cream sandwich and above. Dynamic animations. So Android comes with several animation APIs like animation, animator, view property, animator. But this is new because all the other APIs are based on a concept of duration, right? We want to move something from here to here, like say 200 milliseconds. But this thing is different. Dynamic animation is you specify some parameters and the API can figure out how things should animate according to the laws of physics. Oh, I skipped it. It's like this. So there are two types of dynamic animations in the library. One thing is the spring animation, and it, as the name suggests, it's like spring, you know. Depending on the initial parameters, it moves things back to where it should be. The other thing is swipe animation. That's for swiping. With swipe animation, things moves based on inertia and, you know, stops where it should stop. For the detail, there's a YouTube video you can check out. So we don't have much time, but I really wanted to talk about this because this is something I created. So the latest version of Transition Support Library has many features that were missing in the previous versions. First, it now has all transition types from the latest platform, like change, transform, explode, slide, and everything. Along with them, path motion can be used to add a nice like curving effect to animation, and propagation can be used to add like staggering behavior between multiple views in that animation. Also, we have backported transition XML to the support library, so you can use transition XML like this on ice cream sandwich and above. But when you use an XML, there's this one line you need to add to your build.gradle file, so be careful. Vector drawable compact. So this is very easy. So I think some of you use Adobe or things like that to generate like vector drawable image, like SVG image, and you export it as SVG and import it into Android Studio as vector drawable. And then when you deploy that to your device, it looks like this, you know, some edges are weird. This is because of this fill rule attributes in the SVG, and it was not compatible with older version of Android, but we now backported Android fill type feature called fill type, and it now everything looks fine on even on older version of Android. Animated vector drawable compat has some more backports as well. First, path data morphing. Path data is, you know, it's about shape of a drawable. So buffalo, if you're wondering what morphing means, it's like this. Buffalo, hippo, elephants, buffalo, hippo, elephants, and you get the idea. So these shapes or path data are just a string. They are strings, so we can just declare them in the strings resource. And here we are referring to it from a drawable resource. And we can also refer to them from our animation resource, like this. Now we can create an animated vector drawable to combine those two. Now, so there's one nice trick I want to mention here. If you have a small drawable scattered all around your XML resource, you might be able to use this AAPT colon ATTR to kind of embed one XML into another. So this feature is very nice when you have like lots of XML files that are only referenced once. This feature is not limited to vector drawables. You can use it for any resource XMLs. Now, entirely looks like this. There's also path interpolator. I suppose you're familiar with interpolators, you know, as a nice effect like this. You know, instead of just linearly animating things, you can add some, you know, motion to it. You can create your own custom interpolator now with the path data like this. Just draw the graph with the path data, and the animation interpolates along with it. The usage is just the same as existing interpolators. Just specify them in the interpolator attributes. The result looks like this. So form factors, where's, we are running out of time, so very quickly, you can scroll circle along with our circle. You can put a square inside a circle, and you can also swipe things away. So for the detail, please watch the YouTube video. And there's also on TV, when you're fast forwarding, you want to show like preview, frame previews, and it's much easier to create them now. Also, you can show the playback inside the detail screen. It's much easier to create now. So there are like many other changes in the latest version, but let me talk about some of the highlights. Preference data store. I suppose many of you have used preference activity or preference fragment to create like a setting screen, but that API was limited to storing data into your shared preferences. But with the latest version of the support library, you can use this preference data store to change where you want to store those settings. Like in this case, I'm just extending preference data store as a cloud data store and save the data onto my cloud. So this is how you can change the way those settings are stored. So fragment manager. So some fragment manager transaction calls will now throw an exception if it's called while it's handling a state change. So it's a bit stricter now. So if you see any issue with fragments after upgrading to the latest version of the support library, this might be the cause. And for developers interested in learning more about their UI performance, we've introduced a new class for gathering data about rendering performance. And there's a session about it uploaded onto YouTube by Chet Haas, so you can check that out. Action bar drawable is often referred to as hamburger menu. So it's really easy to use, but one problem is like this, if it animates. So the hamburger menu kind of tries to animate into an arrow, back arrow, but because it's initiated by this drawer coming from the left side, you know, it's hidden beneath the drawer and you can't see the animation, so what's the point? So we were advising people to disable the animation in this case when it's hidden by other stuff. But in order to disable the animation before, you had to write some codes that looks like this. But no, you don't need to do that anymore with the latest version, because we have added this one method that maybe we should have added right from the start. And you can just call this one method to disable the animation. So there are some talks, YouTube videos I mentioned in that session. Here are the URLs. You can learn about the detail here. And so I'll be around the whole day, and I'll be in the Ask the Speakers area from now on, so you can come ask me questions. I believe that's what the Korean sentence says. So thank you. 감사합니다.